the Idries Shah Foundation podcast. Practical Psychology for Today. Featuring the works of Idries Shah, voiced by David Ault. Welcome to the Idries Shah Foundation podcast. In this edition of the podcast, we will hear selections from A Perfumed Scorpion by Idries Shah. This audio has been made available by the Idries Shah Foundation. The Camel Man and the Plastic. There is a true tale about this. I once showed a piece of clear plastic to a camel man. He looked at it and said, "Interesting, but there is no future in it." I asked him why. "Well," he said, "it is not sufficiently transparent to see through properly. It is probably very costly, you can't wear it, and it would not keep the glare out if I used it for a window in a tent." One great advantage of Sufi tales and narratives of encounters which I see, but which many others find irksome, is that they help to make real to the mind the fact that everything has its own correct time. Now this is a part of our daily experience. You cannot catch a train if it is not there, for instance, apart from all the other prerequisites needed to get on that train. But people tend to imagine that this sort of argument is always advanced to stop someone doing something, or to avoid having to do it. It is Sufi experience that people who can keep calm enough to realize that there might be a time and a place and other requirements for anything are more, not less, able to benefit from that thing. Here is a story which is almost always taken to mean that certain things are impossible, but which need not mean that at all. Fish out of water. A would-be disciple begged a Sufi master to teach him exercises. The Sufi, however, said, "I am going to tell you a story instead, then you won't need exercises." He continued, "There was once a man who agreed to train a fish who begged him to help, to live out of the water, being desperate to take up a life on land. Little by little, a few seconds and then a few minutes, then hours at a time, he managed to get it accustomed to the open air. In fact, the fish went to live near him, with its own damp but open-air place in a flower bed in the man's garden. It was delighted with its new life, and often used to say to him, 'This is what I call real living.' Then one day there was a very heavy downpour of rain, which flooded the garden, and the fish was drowned." It makes a good laugh, and it can sound like a derisive tale, but the story only refers to fish, and as it is a story, fish does not have to be an unalterable condition of the person being told it. The usefulness of the teaching story is boundless under the right conditions, though severely limited under two circumstances. The first of these, of course, is when people think of stories as trivial and only belonging to entertainment or for the inculcation of morals and so on, as in the current versions of the fables of Aesop. Even if they are seen to show up amusing sides of human nature, this usage, this opinion about them, blunts their impact. So we can never be confident about the opportuneness until some context has been given about the traditional importance of the story, to enable our hearers to reacquire flexibility of mental approach. The other limiting circumstances is when people have, for some reason, become so bemused by an attitude of awe and a desire for amazing secrets that they are, effectively, consuming that experience, the experience of awe, and get turned on, amazed and bemused by the story itself. It is generally felt that these two attitudes are linked with the individual's desire to define exactly what the story phenomenon is, ahead of his willingness to have explained to him that it is a subtle and very sophisticated instrument. Such attitudes, incidentally, may betray the underlying motivation of the individual concerned as being a thirst for either order or excitement. Is it, we may ask, a desire for knowledge or self-development? We seldom find it wise to dissolve this fixation of choice, as it might be called, since the result usually is someone who may not now be fixated on an erroneous expectation from stories, but still has the desire for, say, explanations or emotional stimulus. The production of basic psychological balance is not the main job of the Sufi, who is always, moreover, aware of the significance of the saying, "Before killing the cat, make arrangements about the mice." Teaching stories do serve as correctives for various psychological conditions, though they are not primarily employed as a therapy, but rather as an illustration of what people are really like. The therapeutic effect, if any, would take place as a part of the entire operation of involvement in the tradition. This is seen as a harmonization and not a treatment. The symptoms disappear, that is to say, when the ailment is not commanding a portion of the student's attention, which is extended for other purposes. The aim to provide the attention capacity with fruitful objects of attention does not treat the symptoms and does not treat the disease. The disease ceases to exist when the whole being is harmoniously balanced. It is not regarded as a therapeutic process, because the intention is not to cure and the procedures are not aimed at the ailment or to make the person feel better, or even to operate better on the ordinary psychological plane. The restoration of the harmony of the individual has, it is believed, higher aims than that, of which a byproduct should be the vanishing of the disability. When a real interest takes over, psychological troubles are remarkably often exorcised by it, a sort of reverse of the proverb, "When the house catches fire, the toothache flies out of the window." This is more than a theory seen from the Sufi perspective, for the learning system, including the use of stories, is both primary and also the same element as has produced the Sufi exponent himself. The teaching is hence not exterior to the practice, and our kind of study is therefore participation activity. It is not objective in the sense that we can have, say, gardeners who never touch a plant, or experts on government who teach it but have never been near a government, let alone having discharged any functions connected therewith. The motivation to study Sufism, or even to familiarize oneself with any of the system's procedures, will, according to the Sufis, only yield results to the extent to which the field as a whole has truly been entered into. Students at a distance will always, of course, continue to obtain what they can from this and all other kinds of study. But the bits and pieces which can be obtained by this method will probably be produced by many other methods, including much more respectable scientific ones, given enough time. There is a short tale which emphasizes the value of knowing what one is aiming for. What he was trying to do. A man went to a Sufi and said, "My neighbor makes my life a misery by visiting me at all hours, hanging about my house, and constantly asking questions." The Sufi advised, "Nothing is easier than the cure for this. All you have to do is to ask the man for money every time you see him, and he will soon start to avoid you." "But supposing he then goes about the town telling everyone that I'm a beggar?" "Ah," said the wise man, "I see that you are hoping to control the thoughts of mankind, not trying to stop your neighbor annoying you. Do you often imagine that you want one thing when you really want another?" The Sufi teaching story, above all, does not require anyone to dress in comic clothes or adopt a peculiar attitude towards anyone or anything. It expects people to enlarge their horizons, but it has to have its own requirements fulfilled in order to operate to an appropriate degree. The introduction of this material into the West attracts all kinds of expectations, and some of them will undoubtedly produce hybrid results which could be absurd. Like all other forms of learning, it needs its own basic teaching institution, and that is not a do-it-yourself one. Someone engaged in self-study, runs the proverb, should not have a fool for a teacher. One story which is current in the West can be used to illustrate what I mean. Doing your own thing. A man once crossed a carrier pigeon with a parrot so that its offspring could speak its message instead of having to carry a written one. But the bird which was produced by this experiment took hours instead of minutes to finish its journey. "Why did it take you so long?" the man asked it. "Well, it was such a beautiful day," said the superior bird, "that I walked." This is why you have Aesop and wise saws instead of developmental instruments. You choose the inculcation of morals alone, or mainly so. One can't help thinking of this story today when people mix all sorts of techniques and exercises in trying for spiritual realization. Their results are as mixed up as the bird in the fable. The results of such hybridizing experiments can be long-lasting. Many are to be found in the East and persist as circuses whose participants, generally, dislike stories and really do fear humor. They call themselves spiritual, however. And since we are talking about tales from the East, we can invoke a slightly different angle on the same subject, that this is an intact tradition with its own requirements. The stories belong to a whole spectrum of reality. They do not mix with cults and bits and pieces. Rather roughly, for the sensibilities of some of the delightful people who are perhaps accustomed to gentler treatment, I take the liberty of quoting a traditional saying often used by people less polished than you or I. If you have been asleep in a kennel, do not ask why you get up in the morning covered with fleas. It is important, at the very least, to familiarize oneself with the whole available range of stories put out in this manner, for they are to be considered the facets of a whole. And in addition, the individual story must be given close attention so that it can yield its optimum value. To go from one to another, choosing those which appeal and giving no attention to those which do not stimulate us so much, however human a reaction, is a sign of a bad and unpromising student in this field. Our habits of lingering over the more desired or more pleasing things in life, when carried over into serious study, can sometimes be barriers to progress in understanding. The difference between these two approaches was borne on me one day recently in an entirely different connection. Why didn't you say? I was staying in the palace of a Middle Eastern potentate not very long ago, surrounded by every luxury. In the morning, the major domo arrived to take any orders, and I thought I would like to hear the radio, but there was not one in my apartments. I asked him to arrange it. "I would like to listen to the radio, please." "Of course. What program?" "The early morning BBC World Service news." The following morning, two men arrived bearing the most advanced radio receiver I had ever seen. "Where would you like it set up?" "Right over here will do fine." One man sighted the set, the other put on headphones and located the station. He looked at his watch. Very soon he gave a signal and the radio amplifier was switched on. At full loudspeaker volume, I heard the stirring march tune identifying London, Lily Bolero, then the news. When it was over, the two picked up their apparatus and silently withdrew. After breakfast, I went to pay my respects to the potentate, who asked me if all was to my liking. "Yes, may your life be long. I did ask them to give me the London news, and they did, but I wished that they had left the radio so that I could listen to other programmes." "My dear fellow," said the sovereign, for he had been educated in England and spoke like that, "you must not blame us, but rather the fact that you are spending a little too much time in the West. Why on earth didn't you tell my chaps that you only wanted to twiddle? Then they would have left it." So, if people interested in Eastern tales only want to twiddle, they should say so. They can, on the other hand, look at the intact system whether presented as Eastern or as a psychological or educational tool. Having insisted that access to the whole range of the activity of Sufi study can only come through involvement in it, as with any other comprehensive operation, one can certainly enunciate other principles which may be of interest and of use to more generalized human areas, though I must stress that they are limited. The zoologist Dr. Desmond Morris, who wrote The Naked Ape and other best-selling books on human behavior, has noted the effect of Sufi stories on his daily life. Many of these, he states, were not appreciated by him at the time of reading, but their message and usefulness were understood when, subsequently, experiences corresponding to the structures laid down in the stories occurred in his dealings with other people. There was a framework for handling situations which he had not had before. The tales as structures. Several scholars, both those specializing in the Middle East and others, have written recently that the tales, as structures which make possible the holding of certain concepts in a particular relationship, have an unusual value, sometimes in helping them to understand ranges of ideas which are not ordinarily linked in any other way. And in the scientific field, for instance, the Mullah Nasruddin stories appear in, of all things, the report of the second Coral Gables Conference on Symmetry Principles at High Energy to illustrate recondite concepts in physics. An interesting experiment is now going on showing that the usage of unfamiliar and even confusing stories and statements could be rendered in terms of one method of switching the brain's action from the sequential and logical to the simultaneous mode. In this latter area, several Sufi tales in my Tales of the Dervishes, which have no obvious point or which are susceptible to more than one interpretation, have been observed to work in this way. The bringing into greater action of the right hemisphere functions and the attenuation of the left may well be the reason for such disjointed injunctions as "think of the sound of no sound." I have myself been impressed to hear a small schoolboy, faced by the flow of words of an unusually lucid and logical youth, shout suddenly at him, "Go knit yourself a slice of cake." The effect was almost instantaneous, stopping the intellectual in his tracks. But it is hardly fair to use this knowledge deliberately to overcome someone else. The holistic overall mode cannot, of course, compete in sequential activity, and seems to take over when the logical one is jammed by such statements as this. I once did this as a test when a Freudian psychiatrist was holding forth on something or other in highly respectful company, lucidly and persuasively. I said, "Well, all Freudians are always saying things like, 'We must find out whether his grandmother bit him in the womb.'" The poor man gasped and stammered, and all he could say was, rather weakly, "But it is physically impossible for that to happen." And this drew such a roar of derision from the audience, whose brains were evidently sequentially operating, that he never regained his aplomb in their company. The secret protecting itself. The more recognizably Eastern mystical master type of tale has an undeniable value in placing relationships into a new perspective, providing that it is employed within limits. If, for instance, these tales are read only as didactic and propagandist, designed to instill belief and create submission to the master's wisdom, they cannot be used for our teaching purposes. Consequently, they get fed into indoctrination cults, or something which has turned or will turn into such a cult. If the message that there are certain times and circumstances, certain arrangements of factors, which have to be observed in order to learn the things being taught by the tradition, is respected and not confused with one-upmanship, the tales can be extremely valuable. I sometimes ask myself, though, whether the phrase much used by Sufis, "the secret protects itself," cannot be applied to such tales, as well as to other areas in Sufi experience. for a paranoid reaction to them effectively excludes the paranoid from that which they have to convey. Such stories are not, of course, the ingenuous attempts by crude esotericists from the East to impress and intimidate inquirers, or to bend them to their will, though some could be used for this by such people. Many an instrument can be used for cruder purposes than its original function. Indeed, one purpose of this exposition of mine is to put people on their guard. Let us look at a sample of this kind of tale, with its built-in aversion therapy element, likely to annoy and deflect anyone who thinks only that he is about to be deceived. A meaning of silence. A seeker after truth who was anxious to find a true master saved up his money and made a long journey to the dwelling place of a Sufi sage. When he was admitted to the grounds of the house, the sage met him and talked for an hour or two about generalities. Since no mystical subject was mentioned, the visitor began to feel disappointed. He stayed in the courtyard of the house, and some days later was admitted to the presence of the Sufi while he sat at his daily audience. The visitor addressed the sage, saying, "I have come from a great distance to inquire as to what might be the mark of a real master, so that I might adopt such a one, should I ever find him." The Sufi gave him no answer at all. When the assembly broke up at nightfall, the seeker went to his lodging. Here he found that another visitor was present, and he mentioned the matter to him. "Your disappointment, which is with the sage, should be with yourself for failing to understand him," said the other. "When he talked generalities to you, he was saying that you were still fit only for generalities, and should not try to converse on any higher subject until a master initiated such converse. When in the assembly, you received only silence to your question. You were being shown that the mark of a real master is to be able not to answer questions put by people who are not able to make good use of an answer already given them." Since I started to publish these stories in 1964, and with an ever-increasing volume of letters, cablegrams, and telephone calls, which is quite astonishing, people have been showing the greatest possible interest in them. The most frequent question is, "How can I use teaching stories?" And a close second is the remark, "I get no spiritual sensations from them." Now, the answer to these questions is really very simple, and I have often been able to get people to produce the answer themselves by throwing the question right back at them, asking them to question their assumptions. This technique, of course, is also advocated in dozens of the published tales themselves. Then, on reflection, they answer, of course, things like, "Perhaps I have to know more before I can use them," and, "Spirituality to me may mean something which gives me a certain kind of emotional sensation linked with specific images, so I may have to perceive what it really is." A different kind of disciple. One of the specialities of the Sufis is to approach the same thing, the needs of the student, from many different directions, so that by what we call scatter, a constellation of impacts, the picture ultimately comes together and he understands. Another story might make this versatility and undogmatic approach clearer. There was once a Sufi teacher who dressed his disciples in robes of wool, had them carry begging bowls made of sea coconuts, taught them to whirl in a mystic dance, and intone passages from certain classics. A philosopher asked him, "What would you do, as a Sufi teacher, if you went to a country where there were no sheep for the wool, where sea coconuts were unknown, where dancing was considered immoral, and where you were not allowed to teach classics?" He immediately answered, "I would find, in such a place, a quite different kind of disciple." It is, in the Sufi area, the possibility of oneself becoming a quite different kind of disciple, learner, or teacher, free from the tyranny of instruments, externals, and dogma, which is predicated in the contention that all secondary ideas and things, among the Sufis, exist only to be dispensed within higher ranges of education, and preferably as soon as possible. Quite obviously, in any community, there are many people who only obtain their sense of identity from such externals and appurtenances. They will not be attracted to the greater and most effective depths of teaching stories. In fact, some are actually almost terrified by them. Teaching stories have been described to me, despairingly, as one long series of testing devices, which is only a little more useful than the phrase that life is only one damn thing after another. However true it may be, is that all that can be seen by such an observer? Very possibly. Teaching stories, I am sure, annoy people because they will say, again and again, that you cannot treat measles by painting out the spots. Copyright 2018, the Idries Shah Foundation.